Hi, my name is Carly McAvoy, and I'm here to talk to you about square roots and the Pythagorean Theorem. Square roots are supposedly a review topic for you, but I just want to talk about those for a minute. When you talk about the square root of 25, the square root of 25 is 5 because 5 to the second power equals 25. This symbol is the radical symbol. And when you see that, let's say I have the square root of x, that expression is asked the question, what number, if any, to the second power equals x? That's what we're asking when we see a square root. So you should be able to find the square root of these, and you can use your calculator. If you need to round to the thousands, do that. And so what you're going to see is the square root of second function square roots. Hit that second function button and then the x squared button, and that gives you the square root of 144. If you know that, then you don't have to use your calculator, which is fantastic. And that's just 12. And that's 12 because 12 times 12 equals 144. That's the question that the radical is asking. What number to the second power would equal this? This is called the radicand, by the way. So now we're saying, okay, what number to the second power would equal 400? Why did I say if any up here? Well, when you say if any, it's because you can't have a negative under a square root like that. So sometimes it's not possible to do it with real numbers. Okay, second function square root 400 equals 20. Excuse me. And so the reason that's true is because 20 times 20 equals 400. That was the question. What number times itself would equal the radicand, or in this case, 400? What about something like 12? Well, if you have second function square root of 12 and you hit enter, then you get a decimal. And so it says up here, round to the thousandth if needed. So to the thousandth is three places. So I have 4, 6, 4, and then I have a 1. So I'm going to go down to 4 instead of up to 5. So I have 3.464. That would be my approximated answer. I should put little equal sign, instead of equal, little approximate signs, because it's not exactly, it's just a rounded number. Not all square roots have an exact number. Okay, sometimes I want to say on certain calculators, especially as you get a more expensive and fancy calculator, if you put square root of 12 into the calculator, you get this. And maybe you don't want that. That's a simplified form. Maybe you want the decimal. If you want to get a decimal answer, when you enter that into your calculator, put a decimal point at the end of the 12, and that just tells it, no, give me the decimal. I want the decimal answer, and it will simplify that for you. That's a nice little trick to know. But anytime you have a calculator and you don't know how to use it, just like you would for your phone or anything else, Google it. Google it to put in, here's my calculator, here's what I need to know, and you'll find a YouTube video that will show you how to use your calculator. Okay, without a calculator, can you say what two whole numbers the square root is between? The answer to the square root, what two numbers is it between? Well, I know that the square root of 100 is 10, and I know the square root of 121 is 11. So the square root of 115 is somewhere between 10 and 11. I don't know exactly what it is, and we're not asking you to tell me exactly. We're just asking you to say, can you do it without a calculator? The square root of 115 is 10.72. So sure enough, it was between 11 and 12. What do you think about number 5, the square root of 40? Well, the perfect squares that I know between that are 36 and 49. 36 is 6 times 6, and 49 is 7 times 7. So I know that if I had the square root of 36, I'd get 6, and the square root of 49, I'd get 7, and I have the square root of 40, so this is between 6 and 7. That's kind of thing, is estimation and getting approximate values are handy and useful as you go out in the world, because you don't always want to know exact, but you kind of want to have a ballpark. Okay. So then the next part of this video is also something that should be a review for you. You shouldn't be hearing Pythagorean Theorem for the first time in your life, even though you may not have remembered exactly what it is. It should sound familiar. Pythagoras is a pretty famous person. You've probably heard the name. For a right triangle, The sum of the squares of the legs are equal to the square of the hypotenuse. So we'll see what that means, but that's what the Pythagorean theorem says. And that is, if you have two legs and the legs come together and form a right angle, so those two sides that form a right angle, those are called legs, and the hypotenuse is the slope side that connects those two legs over here, and we call those A, B, and C. Kind of random, but it's really common to do that. And that what this says is the sum of, that's the addition there, of the squares of the legs. So A squared plus B squared equals C squared. That's what the Pythagorean theorem says. If you took a triangle, 3, 4, 5, and it's a right triangle, and you drew a square over here, this would be a 3 by 3, right, which would be 9. And this one, if I drew a square off this one, and I didn't draw this to proportion, but just get the idea, this would be 4 times 4, which would be 16. And this one, if you drew a square up here, would be a 5 by 5, which would be 25. And 9 plus 16 is 25. That's what the Pythagorean theorem says. If you drew squares off the three sides, the sum of the squares of the legs will equal the square of the hypotenuse. That's the basic idea. With that in mind, then you're going to see problems where they're asking you to find the missing sides. If you know it's a right triangle and you know two of the three sides, you can use this formula to find the missing piece. So here my legs are 6 and 8 and my hypotenuse is C. So I have 6 squared plus 8 squared equals C squared. Now, Pythagorean theorem has a lot of applications in the real world, so it's a good thing to tune into and see if you can understand it. Use it in carpentry. They have a 3, 4, 5 for like roofs and putting things in like that. 8 squared is 64, and then 36 plus 64 is 100. And then we don't want to know what C squared is. Remember up there we talked about the second powers. Let's say the second power would equal 100. Well, that's really saying the square root of. So all I need to do then is say, well, some number to the second power is 100, and I do that by the square root. That's why we just talked about square roots, because we're talking about what about that thing to the second power that would equal that. And so we can use the square root button and find out that it's 10, and we knew it was 10, but I just wanted to show you what you're doing on your calculator. So what we're saying is 6 squared plus 8 squared equals 10 squared. So the hypotenuse is 10 in that problem. Okay, what about in this case, I know the hypotenuse, and I know this side, but I don't know that other leg. So what I have is 5 squared plus b squared is 13 squared. Okay, if you don't know what 13 squared is, 13 and then your x squared button, all you have to do to get that, 169. We know what 5 times 5 is, that's 25. And we have 169 over here. Now I'm going to subtract 25 from both sides. And I get b squared equals 144. Again, we're asking the square root problem, what number to the second power would equal 144? And you can take the square root of both of those sides. We did that one for number one in this video. The square root of 144 turns out to be 12. So the B, or the 12 side, the other leg there, is 12. It doesn't have to be in a picture form. They can just give you two things. In this case, they could have said the leg is 5. Hypotenuse is 13, and you would have said, okay, I know one leg and the hypotenuse. You don't have to see a picture. Here they gave you 9 and 12. That's similar to here because they gave you the two legs. So what we have is a 9 and a 12, and we're looking for the hypotenuse in this case. So we have 9 squared plus 12 squared equals C squared. 9 to the second power is 81. And 12 to the second power is 144. And if I add those together, I get 225 equals C squared. And then I go over here and say, well, what number to the second power would be 225? Second power, 225, is 15. And so C is 15. Is it possible that you would have a problem like this where it wouldn't come out to be a whole number? Yes. You could get 12.72. Just look at the directions. If it says round to the thousands or the hundreds or whatever, you round it to where they ask. What I find is that a lot of Pythagorean theorem problems round to the thousands if they don't come out to be even. So keep that in mind. Have a fantastic day.